Welcome to the Startup Grind.
Shop for what kind of stores they like, what kind of products they like. Why isn't this available? And at that point, we were seeing social networks pop up around every important human area of interest. And shopping was kind of the only thing that was wide open, so I thought, you know, it was definitely worth pursuing. And that's where Wanelo came from. So Wanelo is comes from Wanelo. It's a community for all of the world's shopping. And so it's worth noting that the concept for Wanelo dates back to 2006. And that kind of gives you a sense of the journey, right? So from 2006 to today, it's been quite a long time. And that brings me to my lesson number two. So as you're building a startup, you're going to be continually running into the next big challenge, right? And so I like to think of these challenges as black boxes, right? A black box is essentially something like, say, fundraising, something you've read about, something you know, maybe seen presentations on, and you sort of vaguely know what it is, but you haven't done it, you haven't raised money. And so when you think about the thing, it's kind of scary. And so another good example is, another good example would be building your product, building a team. These are all great examples of black boxes. And so something that I have learned about black boxes is that it's really important to not get caught up in the notion of being able to hear all the startup advice, like process all of it, digest all of it, and then emerge with a perfect solution, and then you go fundraise, right? So perfection is the absolute enemy. And the best way of dealing with black boxes is to just open them and get inside. And it's an approach. I don't know what's happening now. It's an approach that's really worked for me. So let's go through some of the black boxes that I've personally gone through as part of building Wanelo. So product was number one. I don't know where I'm looking at. So I started. I started with this idea. I don't code, as I said. I'm a non-technical person. And my question was, how do I build a solution to this problem that I found? And so in 2007, I shopped around for a co-founder, had a couple of false starts of working with people, but ultimately it didn't work out. So I moved on, and by 2009, found myself with an ability to actually hire engineers in India. So I did that. So our first product was built abroad, and I would just design wireframes, ship them over, and then, this was the result. Happening. Now we're going forward in the wrong direction. So in 2009, the product that we started launching was just bad, and I wish you guys could see, but apparently I have no control over this thing. It is going, it's reacting very slowly, right? So this was some of the, these were some of the early pages that we launched. It's worth noting, obviously there's some images missing, but you kind of get the sense that it was really just bad. I really believe that. And so, shockingly, nobody cared to use it. And I kept on kind of pursuing this vision and kind of building this product for a little while. And then the big breakthrough there was by the end of 2010, I realized that, okay, no one's actually using this thing. Nobody cares. I can't get my parents to use it. Let's try removing some of the things that we build and no one's using. And that's when we have arrived to a version that was much more minimalist. It's gonna happen, it's totally gonna happen. Okay, we removed all the things and we've arrived at this, minimalist. This still doesn't even look minimalist to me, but it was much more minimalist compared to what we had before. But it was about the grid of products, right? That was sort of the big breakthrough moment. I ran a little bit of Facebook advertising, spending $20 a day of my own money on Facebook in order to get a first stream of customers. And people started using it. It was really actually shocking at that point. And then by early 2011, I had closed down my consulting practice, which was my source of income at the time, ended a 10-year relationship, and moved to San Francisco so that I could focus on building Wanelo as a company. And at that point, we had 30,000 monthly uniques. That kind of gives you a sense, right? So it's really, really early community. And so that took me to blog box number two, which is fundraising. Fundraising was something I really, really didn't want to do. Product was fun, and it was something kind of natural for me. I just, you know, for some reason, I have no idea why. It's fun to build it. Fundraising just seemed like so annoying, and you have to like sell your company to people. I really didn't care to do it. And so what I realized was, you know, I had to do it. I had no source of income. I wanted to build this company. And in order to open this black box, I had to actually jump in and do it, right? Like I couldn't, I found myself a little bit paralyzed with all the startup advice that I was seeing. And I just had to say, you know what, I'm gonna go out and make mistakes. I don't really care about this like perfect way of fundraising. So I went out and I really had no idea what I was doing. But the one thing that worked is we were growing through the year. And so what this is demonstrating is actually that, you know, I would send out emails. This is actually a chain of emails to Anne Marico, who's currently speaking in a fireside chat, who's on my board now, where I would send her emails and I'd be like, you know, 500,000 monthly units, 700. So that's really helpful. We were growing steadily, not explosively. That, you know, eventually worked. Eventually Anne said, maybe I shouldn't listen to this girl. So she ended up investing. We ended up closing round. It was awesome. And then I realized that, you know, having just spent a bunch of months fundraising, I had a total of about 40 rejections. So you can imagine sort of how emotionally exhausting that can be. I now have to build a team. I actually didn't have a team at that time. And so that was an interesting realization of kind of just, you know, coming to a point where I realized there's not going to be an end to this. And even though I've just accomplished something such as fundraising, which is like a huge, huge milestone for me, I have to continue. And so that was quite fascinating. You know, and this is just another example. I mean, this is another black box for me. I have no idea how to do public speaking. I'm just learning. And, you know, I'm opening the box and jumping in. lesson number three, the bottleneck. This is something that I think is absolutely critical to figure out. So as a startup founder, as any kind of entrepreneur, you're just going to be busy, right? Things are going to be happening all the time. There are going to be people emailing you, calling you, hire, deal with finances, endless and endless. The one thing I found to be absolutely critical is to reduce this complexity down to what is the single thing that matters? What is the bottleneck to my progress right now? And if you're able to answer this question on a detailed level where you can actually take action, it'll be incredibly meaningful. And one of my favorite things to do, as my team knows, is actually say no. I absolutely adore saying no. It makes me feel very powerful. But the reason why I really like it is that it helps me kind of emphasize that I'm really focused. I know what's important for me and my startup, and that is the thing that I'm going to get done, and everything else is going to be said no to. So to use an example of fundraising, fundraising, again, was, you know, something I really didn't want to do. It was scary. It was a black box. It was overwhelming. And so the way I dealt with this is by asking myself, what is the bottleneck? What is my bottleneck to fundraising, to progress in fundraising? And I asked this question until I got to a single, very actionable point, which was, it's the number of conversations with investors that I'm having, right? And it was very actionable, and that was really meaningful to me, because at that point, all I had to do was just focus on expanding the number of conversations that I had with investors. And so that just was wonderful for me, you know, to go from, I need to raise money, which sounds really scary and I have no idea how to do, to, okay, I just need to, like, have more of these conversations with investors, and then I'll figure it out. So that's really helpful. And so amazing things happen when you do some of these things, and I've experienced, and the last couple of years have been incredibly challenging, but also just absolutely mind-blowingly rewarding. So just to recap, when you dream big and do what you said you would, when you open and get inside the black boxes, and when you stay focused on the one thing that matters. And by the way, one thing I want to add to the one thing that matters is that that will evolve continuously, right? So obviously, as soon as you address that one thing that matters, you need to very, very quickly and urgently move on to the next one thing that matters. And you just kind of keep going in that sequence. And so I'll run through this really quickly. Hopefully the verbal map bite me. So, you know, just a quick glimpse at what can happen in a couple of years and how intense a startup life can be. So just in 2012, our first two engineers joined, and they joined with their own t-shirts, which was super awesome. So these t-shirts say, I want, need, love it. It's really great. certainly made me very happy. Our first launch as a team. Our first app launched in August of 2012. We beat Amazon and eBay in the App Store. It was awesome. Our first 4 reviews ever. And it's really interesting to see how these themes, we get a lot of love from our users. These themes have really persisted through from the very beginning. Our first office, first holiday party. And then, back in the day, in February of 2013, so less than a year ago, we were just 11 people. We had 2 high school dropouts on our team, 1 bathroom, and 3 million registered users. We were the hottest deal in town. This was one of the crazy things that happened. That was just one of those things where, you watch movies and you're like, oh, does that really happen? Happened. We got gifts from investors. Team education, we watched Mean Girls. Our first press, another blog box. Happy birthday, Khan. Khan is an engineer who I personally trolled. I wrote an app update for our iOS release that included his birthday and his personal email, and he got hundreds of emails. It was amazing. Really fun. Our first baby. We bought just a couple of squishables. Squishables are these giant, plush, incredible toys that we found on Wanelo, and just got completely obsessed with them. We grew as a team, and this is a whole other story. Unicorns happen. And now we have a platform that is used by millions of people, which is really fun. That's about it. Thanks, guys. Thank you so much.